Testing.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Can anybody hear me? All right. So my name is Lieutenant Colonel, correction, my name is Colonel Bryant. I am the TICM, the Deputy TICM. I've been in position approximately 1 year, but I've been in several different other positions within the TICM. I started off as a DCO, branch chief, and then I moved up to be the deputy. What we have here is, of course, TICM Cyber. I'm gonna try to introduce my team, so any kind of questions that you may have for me, my team will chime in. I'm gonna start off with DCO. Within TICM Cyber, we have four different categories, four different portfolios that we focus on. We have DCO, Defensive Cyber Operations, OCO, Offensive Cyber Operations, PCTE, Persistent Cyber Training Environment, and SU, Cyber Understanding. I'm gonna start off with DCO, Major Williams. Introduce your whole team if you have anybody else.
You know. Gary Rogers.
OCO. And also SU, OCO also has SU. The SU personnel is not here. He's having issues getting here. PCT. Okay. So, and also on my contract team, we have an outstanding contract support, contract lead. Go ahead. And as Theron has pointed out, as TICMs, we are the user advocates for the organizations to make sure that we provide the requirements and the capabilities for what the Army is desiring. And I want to acknowledge one of our old contractors over there is hiding in the side over there, has a head still down. How you doing, Nadine?
Good morning.
Good morning. All right. Just want to make sure I acknowledge you. Multi-domain battle. This is where cyber actually gets their relevance right here. This is where we come in and actually complete the kinetic force. EW, cyber, this is where we want to pay our dividends and actually executing the prelude of the battle. We actually can go in and jam, the intent is actually to jam radars, disrupt their networks, deny them, disrupt them, or cause deny ability to get to their networks or what have you. And on top of the kinetic, the force, this is the whole diagram of multi-domain battle. Cyber overview. So we must be able to preserve the triad of the CIA, the confidentiality, integrity, and availability of our network. We must be able to do that, and that all starts with the DODIN operations. In DODIN operations, we have the DCO, which I talked about, which has two entities in it. It has the internal defensive measures and the responsive actions. From there, we go to the cyber operations, and the cyber operations is pretty much the sword. That's when we reach out and touch people. That's when we project our force onto the enemy. Any questions? Next slide. Next slide. Hey, so our DCO cyberspace electronical planning has changed from the days of the past. And when I say the days of the past, I'm an infantry branch officer, and I change over to 26 information systems. my days in the talk, brigade talk, and battalion talk, I used to see the everybody busy doing the planning or what have you and stuff, but the signal officer is sitting back doing his own thing. This is no longer going to happen. Right now, the cyber planners are pretty much going to have the DOTA operations, the electrical protect and cybersecurity. They're going to be planning the stuff. They're going to be involved with the DMP process as far as mission analysis, course of development, and course analysis, and actually trying to bring a product to the commander. They're going to inject that course of action into the with the commander and come up with some kind of different targeting stuff. And at different places where they decide to do, either define them, fix them, deter them, block them, or what have you, to create that kind of cyber effect for their maneuver tactical commander. Any questions? This is what we expect. This is what we're gonna expect in 2020, our next major battle that we get into. Bottom line is, it's gonna be congested and contested environment. A kid can go down to Radio Shack and build a jamming system and to obstruct our network right now. That's how bad it is. So we know we're gonna be fighting in that battle. And what we have to do is get to the level of be able to fight in that battle in a congested and contested network. Any questions? These are the capabilities that we need right now. I just got out a 2-hour conversation with the general on how we need rapid acquisition. Right now, the way things are going, we cannot afford to go through the traditional JSIDs 2, 3, 4, 5 years process. We must have a rapid capability of producing the products that we need for the force to exist out there. So it must be rapid, it must be full spectrum, responsive to cyber attacks, and it has to be world class to the soldiers. It has to be easy enough for the soldier to, after he has rucked, marched like 12 miles and stuff, he can open up his system and go to it. It has to be easy enough for him to understand it. We are trying to get to more of an automated systems and for the soldier and the leaders to digest the information and put out the orders. Situation understanding. We talked about situation understanding. So situation understanding is no more than taking sensors, putting on different capabilities that we have out there already. WinT, EW, PMT, DCSA, and Mission Command, taking those sensors, going through analytics, and then creating a GUI interface for the commander to understand. That's nothing more than what it is. We're trying to create a picture for the tactical commander to understand in order for him to make the decisions how he wants to affect the battlefield. Anything you want to add for that? For SU?
Yeah, what else? I'll just say that, so it doesn't add any sensor. I thought I heard this week a lot about sensing the environment, what the Army's working on. So the way to read this slide, you see it again, this yellow box, what's inside the yellow box, that's what the SU capability provides. It doesn't provide additional data feeds, it doesn't provide additional sensors, okay? That's already there, and another problem, it ingests it, correlates it, it aggregates it, and analyzes it, allows for querying, allows for the user to define what they look at, what the level of information is, and presents these types of information elements to the staff to be able to make decisions, support decisions, and understand elevated cognitive level from simply awareness. Right, so the full, the name of this changed a few times. So now it's CyberSU supporting Army SEMA. So
with this, it's going to be actually focused and tailored to the tactical and the garrison. It's going to be across both platforms. And it should be somewhat, we're trying to get it to the points integrated also. It's nothing more than for the tactical commander to have an operational display of what his multi-domain looks like, and he can make the decisions of what he wants to do. He sees this guy over there in the cyber box, actually Facebooking or doing all kinds of different tweets and stuff. He can actually affect different the cyber domains out there.
Still happening, or is it already expired and it's no longer? Is that still part of
questions. Go ahead. No, really, really, it's good discussion. Good discussion. And what you're doing when you discuss things like that, you have in my team up here, they're thinking about the things, some of the gaps that we may have missed and stuff. All right. So I think.
Thank you.
So let me move on and stuff. Good discussion. By the way, I'm not trying to cut you off, but we can have this conversation later on. So the SU tenants, this is what pretty much what we're looking for from the vendors. We are looking for integrated solutions. We're also looking for no proprietary software that's coming from the vendors that we're looking for. We're looking for it to be integrated across. We don't have to come back and get permission to integrate with somebody because it's proprietary. A complete end-to-end, looking at the garrison and tactical views. And each SU is different upon the different echelons. An infantry, rifle, battalion commander, or a brigade commander is looking at something totally different from the logistician person or the aviation person. So it must be tailored towards each outfit that's or organization that's gonna be using it. It must be bi-directional information. It should be ebbs and flows, back and forth. The information goes back and forth throughout the system. DCO. So pretty much, if I'm not mistaken, we got our ons from Army Cyber. Is it Army Cyber we got our ons from?
Yes, sir.
So our ons came down from Army Cyber, created DCO, DCO IS ICD. The DCO IS ICD was approved last year, October 16th, 2016, if I'm not mistaken. It could be, a date could be off a little bit. It went through the JROCM. Since then, we had a new chief of staff. The new chief of staff said he wanted to go through the AROCM, which was not a requirement at first. So now it's going back through the AROCM. That's what I just got out of a two-hour briefing with the general with the ACB board. These are some of the capabilities that we feel as though that the DCO has into it. Actively predict and hunt, outmaneuver the adversaries. That's one of the main things that we're looking for. Have freedom of maneuverability within the DCO channels. 1 second, I get you. Of that, we have the RDPs. One of the RDPs is going with the ICD. That would be the Garrison DCO platform. Right now, we do, which one is already fielded? Which one is the prototype? Is it a tactical or the DD? So we do have some prototypes out there that the cyber mission, the cyber protection brigade is using right now. Those are the things that we are actively using, but they are prototypes, and we're still trying to get it through the wickets and get the rest of it fielded. Go ahead, sir.
Perception of
right, so this slide, this this concept, this OV1 is somewhat kind of busy, and I'm not sure if you can actually see what's going on in here, but pretty much things I want to focus on for this OV1 is a lot of things that Jackie had actually pointed out. It's primarily designed to for us to plan, maneuver, recon, and counter-recon, and counter-mobility, and to clear the different ways of the network and stuff. The main focus of DCO is for us to have freedom of maneuverability throughout the DOTA. Any questions? OCO. So I do not have the slide that I wanted to actually talk on about this, and that actually goes into the ONS and actually different in the RDP packages that we are providing, but I will talk through some of that. The ONS actually came from INSCOM. And right now we're going through the process through DOTIN, DEMO CY, and Army Cyber to actually get it staffed through them to make sure we get it through there for our CG to push it through. Our AROCM date is not until next year, March of next year, if not mistaken. That's the process that we have to go through because we're still going through the J6 process. As soon as we get this rapid process through, we can get the stuff through much faster and get the software and the products out there to the workforce that needs it. With that, we're trying to provide different RDPs with the OCO infrastructure, OCO firing platform, and counter adversary. And I'll let Brian Atherin talk the rest of it.
So this graphic is really just a tie back to SM312 that was just released this year. And so really it gets after kind of some of the components necessary to do offensive cyberspace operations. So as you can see from the arrows here, there's the operational preparation of the environment. So if you move from left to right, it's really supporting, you know, the ability to do cyberspace attacks. And then across the spectrum, again, you have the intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance. So what does it take to, you know, get the picture of what does your enemy look like? And then get that information back to be able to feed it. Again, this is broken down into the blue space, which everybody conceptually knows this has a friendly network. Gray space, which is, you know, all those network appliances, all the things out there, as we know, is the internet. And then red space is really the enemy-controlled networks and resources, whoever those adversaries may be. All getting after the facts that, again, are defined in SM312, which is the deny, degrade, disrupt, destroy, and manipulate both adversaries, systems, platforms, whoever that may be. And we've kind of laid those out as, you know, military targets, mission command targets, and military support targets. So those are all driving forward. And again, as Colonel Bryan pointed out, the required capabilities that we're really looking for is kind of the future build to be able to support this mission set and, you know, meet the operational objectives. Questions?
Really? No questions on this? All right.
You ask. I haven't seen what I would consider different documents. You're talking about either programs that we're going to initiate or communicate with milestones associated with orders like PCO, familiar with PODIS, and you know, current house board trying to do, see, you know, where he's going with that program, can see from OCO is generally not going to be available in public, but but the SU is one where I think that's still happening. So that some of that, I guess, is off of the information about an emerging program.
Go ahead, Jackie.
So in CyberQuest 17, which just happened, we actually put out BAA, broader announcement that actually request SU, and we really didn't get any feedback. And whether that's a misunderstanding, because what we got was a bunch of SolarWinds type network monitoring, which is not what we're after. So for CyberQuest 18, Friday, there's actually a brief where we will go in detail of all our capabilities.
got a question back here, ma'am.
So yeah, so we, so Brock,
red button.
Oh, that's all right. So we, Brock has been all of our, the access enabling tools, effects tools, in the three buckets, counter adversary weapon systems, which we made a little, like on here, military targets, combat systems, whether they be artillery systems, armored systems, that kind of thing. C4I, which we called here our diagram, mission command targets, so think all of your, not just ISR, but adversary computer systems, networks, information systems. And then this is the one where we would say that if the counter for, or the any tool that's required, capability required, to go against civilian telecommunications infrastructure that supports the military or supports our adversary's operations, that would be then either under here or potentially, there's some gray area there. Are they using the command control? Would we consider it C4I? And would we spend that counter, that capabilities up under here, under the C4I one? Or is that part of the support infrastructure that we would consider get it under there? So that part of the strategy, I'll admit, and I think that document that I just referenced that we're working on will lay out the next step. So there's some capability drops that have to follow after this. And there's some question out there as far as that strategy and questions like that. What capability drop and what are you going to be tied to or linked to those capability drops?
And then the other question was about firing platforms.
Cool. All right. PCTE. PCTE is no more than a range equivalent to National Training Center, or JRTC, where kinetic forces go force on force. This is where our cyber forces go force on force. This is when they actually do their training. They get their readiness up, their certifications on this platform right here. The platform was pretty much, the supporting documentation was approved in 29 December 2016. The main gap that we came out of it was our cyber forces lacked a persistent training environment to maintain readiness in order for us to project offensive capabilities or defensive capabilities that we may have. This is congressionally funded, is owned by U.S. Cyber Command. Tikkum Cyber is the combat developer. We're the ones that come up with the capabilities and requirements for it. The PM, across Tikkum Cyber, we have five different PEOs that we deal with. Within those five PEOs, we have about six or seven different PMs that we actually deal with. So we're very busy coordinating, integrating these different PMs and PEOs and stuff. This right here is on a PEO STRI. It's PM ITITS, right? ITS? Okay, ITS. PM ITS. Along this side, these are the owners of the different training sites. And I'm going to have Josh step in because Josh is probably itching to step in to make sure that I'm saying that this is his baby right here. These are the SCCs right here that we have supporting this effort. Anything I missed out on, Josh?
And so congressionally funded already, so a lot of the stuff you can see in the acquisition process for Milestone B, we kind of got to Milestone A, so we're still reaching towards Milestone B. And just so you know, there's a lot of oversight from an acquisition program edits, and then of course
this is the OV1 for the PCTE. I'm going to try to break it down to you. I'm sure Josh is going to chime in. For our range resources, we pretty much have three different range resources. We have the National Cyber Range, which is located in Orlando, Florida. We also have the Cyber Security Range, which is located in Stamford, Virginia. And then we also have the last one is the C4AD, is in Suffolk, Virginia. Those cover the different range right here. From there, we have the different crew training facilities. We have, I think, about five different locations for the different crew facilities. We have one in Hawaii, Fort Meade, Stamford, San Antonio, and the other one is Fanex I. Where's Fanex I? In Maryland. From there, we go into the different networks that we use to each color code goes to the different networks that we have, and it goes into different scenarios. So basically, we go into event management, and the way I like to articulate this is it's pretty much that you have different scenarios that people come in, and it's like a library. You come in, I want to do this scenario, I want to train on this scenario. From there, that scenario will be recorded and put back on a shelf, and maybe somebody else may want to come and use that same scenario. So each scenario is going to be created. Go ahead, you want to ad-lib on this one?
Phase one, or IOC, is scoped by the R&D that is focusing on crew collective and force level training for the cyber mission force only. So I get a lot of questions about what about the rest of the DoD cyber workforce, right? That's more desired end state than the meat and potatoes. It's really conceptual right now, even though it is defined and have a capability design, if you will, based on the ICD.
So again, this thing is focused on individual training and crew collective training. Any questions? So this is the end state. I'm going to let you talk to end state.
So for end state, the biggest difference is now instead of just crew collective and force, we're looking at individual, and we're also want to develop a capability that supports multi-domain. Okay. So what that basically means is our training audience grows, it broadens.
So you actually hit on a good point. I mean, going back to the different tables of levels of expertise where they go through. I can talk on this before, some of the fact that coming from the infantry range, you have different gunnery tables. And it's going to be the same thing, I think, if I'm not mistaken, Paul Stanton has come up with the same philosophy with a field artillery guy coming up with different gunnery tables that you must go through. And from that, you will have different categories to get to table 7, table 12, in order to be proficient or at your crew skills or at your individual skills. And with that, you also have the library that you can pull different scenarios from. The main thing that they're competing with right now is range control. Who's going to be range control? Who's going to control the different the range, and who's going to get on who's not, and what have you and stuff. So they're working through that right now. He's working through it, and that's one of the things that we'll resolve shortly with this. Any other questions? 4 minutes. Thanks. Discussions. I made it. Any questions, concerns, alibis that you may want to bring up? I don't know. So I know you from somewhere in San Antonio.
Yeah. So it is a joint program. So it touches all services.
Okay. So I think the answer you're looking for is the range concept. So if the Air Force has their range, their training service specifically, it should be able to tie into and interact with you. Again, as a joint, they're not looking at training.
Everything you needed.
Good.
I'll touch you.
All right.
That's a good question. What do you tailor to the environment? Or is it just since you're in here, does it need to get a name of the box and name of the certified part?
Is it going to be a certain contract, or is it going to be an overarching government contract that will become better providing input into some other systems?
Any other questions? Comments? Okay. Well, this concludes our briefing. My team will be around for any kind of one-on-one discussions if you have any.